In the past few weeks, quite some progress has been made in bringing Homebrew onto the Nintendo Game & Watch. We now have a working basic NES emulator running on the system, a basic Game Boy emulator, a basic Doom as you saw in the last video, and also a base project for others to start developing new things for the Game & Watch. Now in this video, I want to walk you through the process of getting your device ready for Homebrew development. I want to show you how you can use our scripts to backup and restore the original firmware of the device, and how to install Homebrew software on the Game & Watch. I should note that all of this is not yet ready for daily use or anything. Things like save games, standby, and so on are not yet implemented, but we hope that with these instructions we can motivate other developers to join the fun and help improve the software, so that eventually we have something that is easy to install and not just targeted at developers. Now all the tools you will see were built together with Konrad Beckman, an awesome hardware hacker from Sweden. Go follow him on Twitter for a lot of super interesting stuff. He also regularly live streams Game & Watch development, which is super interesting to see. Let's get started with what you will need. Besides the actual Game & Watch unit and also a tri-wing screwdriver, you will need an SWD programmer. Now you can get these very cheap ST-Link clones, though they have a couple of disadvantages. On the ones I tried, the reset line is not functional with STM32s, and also they do not adjust the digital signal levels to the target voltage. A great alternative is to get an STM32 Nucleo development board, such as the one I used in my bare metal reverse engineering video. That board has an ST-Link debug probe on board that you can separate from the dev board, and it works nicely with a Game & Watch. Alternatively, you can also get a dedicated debug probe, such as an original ST-Link or a J-Link. The scripts we use in this video work both with ST-Link compatible probes as well as with the J-Link. Finally, you need a way to hook up the debug adapter to your Game & Watch. You can use test clips, you can solder on wires, or for example, like I did on this unit here, solder on a regular 2.54mm pin header. The exact pinouts and how to connect them to the device are linked in the description of this video. Also, as I know the question will come, the USB port does not have its data pins connected to the processor, and so it will not be possible to homebrew the device without opening it up. Though a couple of people are already working on some nice USB mods. Let's start with backing up the original firmware of the Game & Watch and unlocking the processor. To do this, we have published a dedicated repository, the scripts in which make it relatively simple to backup and restore your device. Currently, they run only on Linux and macOS. However, if you're interested in porting the scripts over to Windows, a pull request is more than welcome. So let's start. I've hooked my Game & Watch to a debug probe, and I've also powered it up via USB. Also note that I've disconnected the battery. Next, let's go into the Game & Watch backup repository, and let's run the first script. This script simply does a sanity check on whether all required tools are available. Next, let's run the second script. We just need to tell it which debug probe we are using, and we are good to go. It asks us to turn on the device and set it to the time mode. Once we hit return, this script will first download a part of the memory from the device to the computer, which will be used later to encrypt our payload for dumping the internal flash. Then it will load a tiny SPI flash dumper program into RAM. That program will copy the entire contents of the SPI flash into RAM, and then we save it to the computer. It also verifies the integrity of both dumps to ensure that your backup is fully working. The next script encrypts a tiny payload and writes it into the SPI flash. As this will modify SPI flash contents, the script asks for additional confirmation. Then it flashes the payload using our flash loader, which is an SPI-based flasher that runs directly from RAM on the device. After a couple of seconds, we have to follow a short procedure. Power off the device by removing USB power, plug it back in, keep the power button pressed, and hit return. This will execute the payload, and the script will then load a copy of the internal flash into RAM, from where we can then dump it. Now we have a full backup of both the internal firmware of the device, as well as the SPI flash contents. This means that we are able to unlock the read protection of the processor now. This will cause a mass erase of the internal flash, and so it's the most destructive part of the process. But as we have a backup, nothing should go wrong. After we have unlocked the device and power cycled it, we are now able to restore the original firmware using script number 5. And after a short wait, we are back in business. Our Game & Watch is running the original firmware again, but with an unlocked processor. Perfect. Now we are able to flash Homebrew, and we will be able to go back to the original firmware at any time. Now in the last video, you already saw the basic Doom I've ported over, and in this video, we will load a work-in-progress NES emulator onto the device. Konrad started porting the Nofrendo-based NES emulator from the RetroGo project over to the Game & Watch, and after a couple of days we got it working quite nicely. It's running at 60fps, sound is working, and it's definitely already a lot of fun to play. Save games are not working yet, standby needs to be implemented, but it's great to see all these things heading into the right direction. To allow you to try it out easily, I've published a pre-built version of the NES emulator, including the open source Pawn Adventure Z NES ROM. You can install it by running the install Pawn Adventure script. We've also started porting a Game Boy emulator and some other things, so I think we will see quite some fun stuff in the future. Now, if you're interested in porting or maybe even writing an original game for the Game & Watch, we are also today publishing our Hello World project, a simple STM32 CubeMX based base project that shows you how to write to the screen, how to read the buttons, how to play audio, and so on. So if you're interested in developing for the Game & Watch, this is a great place to get started. In a future video, we will take a more technical look at how we are actually dumping the internal flash and what goes into bringing Homebrew to a new device, so please subscribe. We also will take a look at a couple of possible hardware mods. For example, we will replace the relatively small 1 MB SPI flash with a larger 16 MB one. I hope you enjoyed this video, and I hope to see you on this channel again soon. Thanks!